God, they won't say they're angry with God, but they are. And they'll do things to you to spite you. Let's turn your Bibles to Exodus chapter 17. Beyond a reasonable doubt this morning. They won't even convict you in a court of law if it's beyond a reasonable doubt. Or at least they should not. But Christ is beyond, way beyond reasonable doubt. Hallelujah. How many people agree with that? Beyond reasonable doubt. But yet, most of the world today, and the way some of our children are going today, they want to classify him as something he is not. Not realizing. Exodus chapter 17. We're going to start with verse 1. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Are you ready for the word this morning? Hallelujah. Many people know that just must live by faith. That thing, the Bible says that Christ is the author and the finisher of our fight, of our faith. So he is the head of the church. Hallelujah. He's Alpha and Omega. Yeah. One who is, and who was, and who is to come, the Almighty. He is the Almighty. The one who is and who was. Can you imagine any man, any deity other than God being put in these words? One who is and the one who was and who is to come. The Almighty, Revelations 1 and verse 8. My God, Revelation 1 and 8. Let's look at, put on the board Revelations 22 and verse 13. 22 and 13. He says, I am the Alpha and Omega. Christ says, I am the Alpha and Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Hallelujah. Can you understand the world has rejected this Christ that we serve? And he says, I am the Alpha and Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. How can the world justify themselves by rejecting the Alpha and Omega? There's no words that's ever been written about a Savior like this. Christ said he didn't come to judge the world, but he came that the world might be saved. He came to bring salvation to the world. He came to save the world. And the world didn't need a judge because it had already been judged by God, but the world needed a deliverer. The world needs a Savior, but yet they have rejected him, even though they failed to read and to study his word to find out who he is. Therefore, he says, I am the Alpha and Omega, the first and the last. I am the beginning and the end. My God, he says in 1 John 2:1, he says, my dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. If anyone does sin, he said, I write to you so that you won't sin. He said, but I'm not going to throw you away, put you down, destroy you if you do sin, because I have not come to judge the world at this time. The world must be judged. And I have come as a deliverer the first time. I have come as a Savior the first time. I have come, my God, that I may deliver man from the power of Satan, from the power of death, hell, and the grave the first time. But he said, now I'm in heaven at the right hand of the Father, and I am an advocate. My dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anyone does sin, don't give up, don't quit. Don't throw in the towel, because this body of flesh, this body of affliction, there's no good thing in it. It's bad enough when everybody hates you, but when you hate yourself, it's over. Satan wants to make you hate yourself. It's bad enough when people don't like you, and people have all kinds of reasons for not liking you. In fact, when they don't like you the most, you'll never know it. They'll smile in your face, but they don't like you. And they don't like you not because there's something bad about you. A lot of times they don't like you because there's something good about you. My God, there's something good about you. I know we put that arrow on 60 today, right? I know I didn't have to tell anybody that today, right? Because I'm looking at it. Hallelujah. Beloved son, he's called the bread of life. Okay, let you go to Hebrews 12 and 1. Hebrews 12 and 1. Christ has come into the world, and the world has, they have gone beyond. They don't have reasonable doubt. They have gone beyond reasonable doubt. They won't even take their time to see who the Son is, to know whom the Son set free is free indeed. And they cannot even look at the evidence of the world. If this thing had went before a court or a jury, surely, hallelujah, they would not be able to convict him beyond a reasonable doubt because of the evidence, the trail of saints that's left behind, because of the word of God that established a covenant with Abraham. My God, and then not only did he establish a covenant with Abraham before he became the son on earth, before he was born of the woman, God had already established a covenant with Abraham. But he told Abraham through Isaiah, he said, unto us a son will be given, unto us a child will be born. His name shall be called Counselor, Wonderful, Hallelujah, Prince of Peace, Everlasting Father. He is going to come in the world, a sign, my God. And not only that, God didn't just become the God of Abraham, but he continued the covenant, and he became the God of Isaac, and he became the God of Jacob. So we call him the God of Abraham, and he didn't stop there, because Abraham never was able to achieve what needed to be done in his lifetime, because this is 2,300 years later. So now, since Christ has ascended, a couple thousand years since he made a covenant with Abraham, so he didn't only become the God of Abraham, but Isaac and Jacob. Can you imagine in your family that he is the God of you and your child and your children's children? That's who he is, my God. And we should know him and accept him, my God, because there's no such thing as reasonable doubt when it comes to Christ. The Bible says he is an advocate. My God, it says he is the author and perfecter of our faith. That's Hebrews 12 and 2. He's the author and perfecter of your faith. He did not only author faith. He didn't only create faith. He is perfecting your faith. So if your faith is being perfected by Jesus Christ, then all you have to do, hallelujah, is follow him. All you have to do is understand his methods and how he deals with us. And you will see that it's from faith to faith and glory to glory. The most precious thing about God is when it looks like it's all over, when it looks like no one else is for you, when it looks like that nobody can do anything for you, it's a hopeless situation, when it looks like the door is closed, the way is closed, there's no bridge over troubled water, and you find God will come through Jesus Christ and make a way out of no way. When it looks like you've come to the end of a thing, you find out, yes, it's the end of that thing, but it's beginning of something else. Amen. Hallelujah. That's the God we serve. Hallelujah. I said, I am the Alpha and Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. We have a God in Jesus Christ that says, I'm the first and the last. I'm the beginning and the end. Who would not understand that that's who God should be? Who would not understand that's the kind of God we should serve? My God, we should serve a God like that, the perfecter of our faith, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the author, perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. He sat down on the right hand of the throne of God. The Bible says, my God, he endured. He endured the shame. Endured the shame. My God. And sit at the right, despising the shame. And sit down at the right hand of the throne of God. He sat at the right hand as the throne of God. Because in order that man could be saved from the wrath of God. It's the wrath of God that a man has to be saved for, not the wrath of Satan. The wrath of God, in order for the man to be saved from the wrath of God, man had to pay a price. God himself took on the form of a body, came into the earth realm, and set aside, hallelujah, did not consider himself, but he gave up his authority, he gave up his rights, and he obeyed the Father unto death. Hallelujah. Did not consider robbery to equal himself with God, because he was God. But now as man, hallelujah, in heaven. Only God, if God can become a man, can he become a rock? The Bible tells me that when Moses struck the rock the second time, he struck Christ, because Paul tells me he is the rock of our salvation. God didn't say, where can I go and not find God? See, people cannot understand that God can become a man, but man cannot become God. Once they realize that God can become a man, then they understand that we know that all these things can work together for the good of those who love the Lord. And call, your day is not over. Your day is just beginning. God has to make your day hard sometimes to keep you in the way. When God called the children out of Egypt and out of captivity, just like the black people that came out of slavery in America, it was hard for them. They didn't have any jobs when they came out. They didn't have anybody helping them when they came. Well, somebody's always on the scene to help you, but they didn't have the kind of help. Just like the children of Egypt, they went into a wilderness. They went into the desert of sin. They didn't even have water. How did they survive without water? You can do a whole lot of things in the earth, but when you're thirsty, you got to have some water, because dehydration is about to set in. And that's where we find that they went into the desert. But I want to tell you a little bit more about this perfecter of our faith. I want to tell you a little bit more about the authority of Jesus Christ. If you look at Matthew chapter 28 and verse 18, I want to show you a little bit about the authority. See, people that won't stay under authority. God of Jesus Christ, you got to be on authority of Jesus Christ in order for him to make that way special for you, in order for him to close those doors and cut the enemy off from attacking you. You have to stay on the authority. Say, Jesus Christ, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. All authority in heaven and earth. So Jesus said, as the man, Christ, as the last Adam, my God, as the last Adam, as a man that's been given dominion over the world, God says, not only did Jesus Christ get authority over the world, but the Bible said all authority in heaven has been given to him. If all authority in heaven and earth been given to Christ, I think I can preach about Christ. I think I can believe Christ. I think I can forgo the hardships and those things that I see with my eyes and understand that he will make a way, because all authority has been given unto him. It says he's the bread of life. That's John 6 and 35. Jesus Christ declared, I am the bread of life. See, not only do you need water when you're thirsty, you need bread in order to live. And Jesus said it this way, man does not live by bread alone, but every word that comes from the mouth of God. So your spiritual man. I was in the hospital visiting some people today, and I saw a man that was sick, and I know he had some IVs. I know he had some nurses. I know he had some doctors. But Paul says, oh, this body of flesh, who can deliver me from this body of affliction? Wow. The body was afflicted, but yet the spirit of the man is still willing. So when a Christian go into the hospital, we don't take natural bread. We don't need to stop at Bojangles. We don't need to stop, my God, at McDonald's. We need to take some spiritual food. And if you can't take the word of God, and if you can't go in the authority of Jesus Christ, you might as well go up as a visitor. You might as well just get your bag and go and sit down and let everything happen that's going to happen. But the Bible tells me that if any sick among you, let him send for the elders of the church and the prayer of faith will save the sick. My God, we don't care what people think that don't know when we go in there, because guess what? We know that their doubt is not reasonable. We know when we go in, the demons have to tremble. For when Christ was in the earth, they said, we know who you are. Have you come? Have you come to destroy us? Have you come to destroy us? knew the time, but they didn't know what Christ was going to do. They didn't know that Christ was coming to die. They didn't know that Christ was coming. Even though he was coming to die, he still had authority over them because they knew who you were. I heard him say this, Peter I know and Paul I know, but who are you?
Who are you?
Who are you? See, you got to remember that they know you because you've been born again. Uh-huh. You got to know that you got to understand because you believe the author and finisher of your faith. Because you believe God is going to put you in a place where you can achieve. But faith do not come without a test. Your faith has got to be tried and your faith has got to be authored. Your faith has got to be tested.
Uh-huh.
My God, it's got to be tested. Every time the devil's trying to kill you out, my God, somebody come by and tell you how beautiful you look today. How your words have already inspired them. How, my God, I'm so glad to see the smile that's on your face. You understand what God is doing. They see God through you.
Amen.
My God, he's called the bread of life. And if you look in Matthew 3 and 17, he's called the beloved son of God. God did not need a son, but we certainly needed a savior. God could not violate his own word because the wages of sin is death. And if a man died in his sin, how must he live again? So God had to send someone that not only could lay his life down, he couldn't only lay it down, but what else he could do? He didn't only have to lay it down, but he had to have some power to pick it back up. He had to have some power to take it back up. And because he took it back up, the Bible says you will never taste death. You may be dying, but you will never have the taste of death in your mouth. Hallelujah. My God, because you have already been bought with a price. The Bible calls him the bridegroom. If you look at Matthew 9 and 15, it says, and Jesus said, and Jesus said to them, can the wedding guests mourn as long as the bridegroom is with them? Mm-hmm. The day will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them.
Wow.
And then they will faint. My God, you can fast now because the bridegroom has been taken away.
Well,
but I can tell you one thing about it. Mm-hmm. He's coming back.
He's coming back.
But the Bible says the joy of the Lord is my strength.
My strength.
If you know what, God will allow you to go through something until you can go through it and come out a winner. You have to go through it over and over again. Because guess what? You can go through anything as long as you know who you belong to. As long as you know who's going to bring you out. My God, I was listening to the praise and worship upstairs. And when I was up there, I said, my God, it sounds like everybody in town. My God, because guess what? They were moving by faith, not by sight. My God, and they were moving in the power and the spirit of the Lord. Hallelujah. Chief cornerstone. That's Psalms 118 and verse 22. The chief cornerstone. My God. So the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. You have to remember that the world has rejected this Christ that we serve.
Well,
do you understand it's not as easy to serve Christ as it once was? Because the whole world has rejected Christ. Except those that are saved. And my God, he's saving them every day. My God, he's saving men and women every day. But a lot of times you won't know who he's saving because you won't know. Because, see, the world is trying to put us in a corner. The world is trying to keep us where we don't want to be proud to say that we're Christians. But I thank God we live in a nation where we can still lift up the name and raise up the name of Jesus Christ. My God, the Bible calls him in 1 Thessalonians 1 and 10. The Bible calls him a deliverer, says, and to wait for his son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus who delivered us from the wrath to come. There's a judgment to come on the world.
Yes, Lord.
There's a wrath to come on the world.
Well,
and when this judgment come on the world, and the world finally realized that the one they rejected the most, the one they put in a category, the one that they rejected and start raping, said, well, we need to serve God on the Sabbath and not on Sunday because God never did away with the Sabbath. Never understanding that, my God, that They could not go back into the garden, because once God put man out the garden, he put an angel with a sword, a flaming sword that went across. They could not go back in once Noah, my God, had came out the ship. That part was over. And once Christ came into the world, we did not have to, my God, serve God with the Sabbath anymore. Uh-huh. We did not have to take a lamb anymore, sacrifice it, and take it to the high priest. We did not even need the high priest anymore, Lord, because he became the high priest. Yes, hallelujah. The Bible says he is a mighty God, an everlasting God, the Prince of Peace, and he is the chief cornerstone. He is the beloved Son of God. He is the bread of life. He is the author. He's the author and perfecter of our faith. He's the advocate. He's the Alpha and Omega. And Christ is the Almighty God. How many people do you think in the world know Christ the way we are describing him now? They don't know him because they don't want to go beyond a reasonable doubt. My God, the moment somebody tells them something, without who God is, that without who Christ is, they would say, if God is God, he didn't need a son. And why should a man have to pay a price for sin when he was born into sin? It's not his fault. But God allowed you to be born in sin through Adam, but he gave you a way out. And if you don't take the way out, then there won't be any way out. Well, somebody say, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Now we're going to go to Romans chapter 7. We're going to go to Exodus chapter 7. And I want Elder Garland to read that first verse. Now, what I want to show you is when you go through the desert, you're going to go through some dry places anytime you serve God. Because in order for you to put on the garments that God is going to give you, you've got to go through some as many bitter Christians, as many people in the world bitter, because the Bible said they have a lack of understanding. But my Bible tells me if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves, my God, if they will humble themselves, my God, seek the face of God, turn from their wicked ways, God said then they will hear from heaven and their land would be healed. So it's so many people that are angry with God and they try to honor with God. You can't reason with God because God is beyond reason. There's not a season for God. There's a season for man. There's not even a time for God. How can you put a time limit on God when God is the creator of time? God is the one that holds time to account. Time has got to do what God says. God calls time to account when he wants to. He can turn back the hands of time if he wants to. I want you to read that first verse for me, Elder Garland.
Exodus 17 and 1. At the Lord's command, the whole community of Israel left the wilderness of Sin and moved from place to place. Eventually, they camped at Rephidim, but there was no water there for the people to drink.
Hallelujah. God sent them to a dry place.
Yes, Lord.
Have you been in a dry place?
Amen.
I say some of you in a dry place right now. The only thing can help hold you up out of a dry place is your faith. And my God, you know, some people, I went to the hospital almost every day last week, sometimes twice a day, and sometimes late at night. And I saw a man this morning in the hospital, and he was a very sick man. I looked at him. His wife was in a chair laying beside him. I went in. I told her, I said, don't even get up. I said, let me pray for your husband. I'm only here for a little while. I didn't come to visit. I came, hallelujah, to bring the word of God, the power of God, and the authority of God into the room. When God is in the room, my God, sin sick get saved or healed. So when you go in a situation, you can't afford to look at the situation. You can't even afford to ask questions. But Jesus Christ went into Tabitha's house and he said the damsel was not dead, but this damsel was only sleeping. My God, the Bible said they laughed him to scorn. They went from mourning and weeping till they went to laughing him to scorn. But he put them all out.
Yes,
and he kept Peter, Paul, and John with him. And he said and told the damsel to rise and be healed. And she came up and she was about 12 years old. And he said, give her something to eat. She's hungry. Anytime you go in a hospital and you see somebody trying to eat something physical, they're hungry physical, you know they're not that sick. You know they're on their way to recovery. Because one thing about eating, my God, in a natural sense, it's a good sign that you're on your way to recovery. Because a person, when they stop eating, they're really sick. Because the body has to have nourishment in order to live. So We read verse 2 for me, Elder Garland.
So once more, the people complained against Moses.
Uh-huh.
Give us water to drink, they demanded. Quiet, Moses replied. Why are you complaining against me? And why are you testing the Lord?
Keep going.
But tormented by thirst, they continued to argue with Moses. Why did you bring us out of Egypt? Are you trying to kill us, our children, and our livestock with thirst? Then Moses cried out to the Lord, What should I do with these people?
Okay, hold it right there. They are ready to stone me, Moses said.
Wow.
Now what happens is a lot of times we have to appreciate where we are with God.
Come on now.
See, you don't know where you are. God has prepared us. Some of us, he prepared us for one day. Moses spent 40 years on the backside of the desert learning, hallelujah, learning something from God. Number one, he became a deliverer. Number two, he had such a hard time on the backside. But my God, when he was in the house of the Pharaoh, and he was treated like a king. My God. And then when he went back to the people had no regard for him because they were thirsty. And when you are leading people, and my God, you are thirsty. When you are leading people and the people become hungry, they're ready to stone you to death. But you have to understand, when you're following God, God is the supplier of the needs of the people. They're not your people. They're God's people. As many people have left the church because of a congregation and left God because of a pastor. Because they're trying to judge the pastor or the congregation or another saint instead of understanding that God beyond reasonable doubt. Understand that Jesus Christ is the way. Understand that he came as a savior and he's coming back as a judge. He didn't come as a judge, for he told them, I did not come. I did not come to condemn the world, but I came that the world might be saved. When you take this message that God has given man and you look at the rejection that man has upon the message, how many people in the church can believe that they might be saved through Jesus Christ if they hold on to the faith and they allow the faith to be perfected? But I'm going to tell you what happened to the people. Moses had some no good people in the crowd. He had some complainers and murmurs in the crowd, and they were talking to the other people. They were. It's bad enough to be thirsty, but my God, when you got somebody in there accusing Moses, accusing God to you, then you begin to think your doubt is reasonable. They say, well, my doubt is reasonable. You can't see everything wrong because God is beyond reason. What kind of man can stand in a boat and say, peace be still, peace, and the whole storm will clear? What kind of man would send a saint, born-again Christian, into a hospital with very little faith and, my God, see a miracle? Did a man, when he sees a miracle, do he come out and say, I just healed somebody? Or does he come out and say, God just heal somebody through me? And then you got to say, my God, God used a wretch like me. See, you got to go in the hospital, understand that you're not going in your righteousness, because your righteousness will be good enough to get into heaven. You're not going in your righteousness, but because your flesh has no good thing in it. The body has one good thing in it. The flesh has nothing good in it. And the only thing the body's got good is your spirit. And your spirit, hallelujah, is what God connects to. And my God, and that's why the demons tremble. That's why they know you. When you come in, they say, here come one of them serious Christians. Here come one of them Christians that don't care if you get up, don't care if you lie down. Here come one of them Christians that understand that I'm doing what God told me to do. I'm not looking and worried about how you feel after I leave, how you feel after I pray. I'm not worried about anything except doing what God sent me in the hospital to do. Lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. Speak the word of God. Bind what's on earth and it shall be bound in heaven. Be bound in heaven. Loose what's on earth and it shall be loosed in heaven. Loose the angels up in here. Because that person you're looking at may not look like they're going through no turmoil, but I'm telling you that they could be demons from the pits of hell all looking for. Jesus said there was a man in Mark chapter 5 and he was full of devils. My God, everywhere he went, the people say he cut himself. My God, and he broke chains. He lived among the tomb in the graveyard. Do you know how many insane people there is in the world today? There's so many people that's not just crazy, but we have a bunch of half crazy people in the world. You got people that's so crazy, when you look at their eyes, they look like they're about to throw a fit. They're so messed up.
Well,
they're so jacked up. Because when you look at their life, my God, what do they believe? They believe they're kind of freaky people. They come out at night and they do everything under the sun. They look like a crazy man. And they act like a crazy man. And so the doctors want to know, does this craziness run in your family?
Well,
if you want to know if it runs in the family, you want to find out what kind of sin runs in that family.
Well,
my God, I thank God that he saves a man right now that came up in a house where nobody got saved. He'll save a child today that came up in a house where everybody was full of devils. And he'll pull him out of that house and save him. My God, look what he did to David. David was a man after God's heart, but yet David killed a man. I had a pastor talk to me yesterday. He said, God has got such grace. He said, oh, God's grace is so good. He said, my God, he must have been studying, because some of these pastors, we run a message past each other. He said, God's grace was so good. Oh, God's grace is good. What do you think about how God forgave David after not only did he take the man's wife, he killed the man? I said, what I think. I said, it wasn't God's grace, because God's grace is sufficient at all times. God's grace is always sufficient. God don't tell you how his grace is, whether it's good or bad. He just tells you it's sufficient. But what happened is, Moses, my God, you got to look at Moses. Here's a man that God was able to forgive. Here's a man that loved God. And because he had a position and a title, and he did something wrong, he tried to cover it up and not even think that God knew about it. But not only did God use David as an example to say, I'm going to forgive you, but he forgave him.
Yes, he did.
Because the grace that God has will forgive a murderer, just like it would forgive a rapist. The grace that God, see, the Christian church don't understand the grace of God. That's why they go around angry with people. That's why they go around angry with each other. They'd rather be angry with you because God put you in a position to understand that God didn't put them in a position because he's trying to protect them, because he know greed will destroy them. He know they're not where they need to be. My God, and even when he put a pastor in a church, my God, he gonna see if you think about the things that matter to God before you think about the thing that matter to you. Am I right about it? Hallelujah. So you understand, it's not so much the grace of God, for God's grace has already been there. What it is, it's not the grace of God. God's grace has already always been there. Let me tell you what was hidden. Let me tell you what the problem was in the world. The problem was God's mercy.
Glory!
Mercy had to be satisfied. Mercy was behind the veil.
Yes, Lord.
Mercy had to have the blood, innocent blood.
Well,
my God, in order for God's spirit to remain among men, God had to pour his wrath out.
Well,
upon that mercy seat. For God put mercy between the two cherubs.
Yes,
and
Lord.
When the blood went between the cherubs and that innocent blood and the wrath of Shekinah glory of God came down, then God, we can say, Lord, have mercy.
Have mercy.
Mercy is just like grace now. There's no such thing as a saint that don't have mercy. You don't have to get the priest to go behind the veil once a year in order for you to get some mercy. You don't have to never had to hide grace behind the veil. Am I right about it?
Amen.
Grace was never behind the veil. My God. But mercy, it took something to get some mercy. And when David got mercy, he wrote Psalm 51. My God. He said, Lord, whatever you do. Whenever I'm such a bad person. He said, whenever you have mercy on me and don't take away your spirit. There's so many Christians right now, that they don't understand that there's no good thing in this flesh. They're judging themselves and they're judging everybody else by the flesh. When they should understand that, my God, that mercy, the Bible said truth, the law came through Moses. But grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. See, right now, they had grace in the world. They had grace in the world, but they didn't have truth until Christ came in the world. How are you going to have truth in the world until Christ came? You can't have no truth in the world without Christ. You can't. Why? Because there was no deliverer.
Preach
about the blood of bulls and goats did not satisfy the wrath of God. It did not set you free. The penalty of death were laid aside,
yes, it was.
And the guilt of the people were sent to the desert gonna be born through Isaiah. Wow. The Bible tells me in Isaiah 61 that when Christ went into the temple in Luke chapter 14, Anyway, Christ went into the temple, the synagogue. Now, a priest operating in the temples. Well, but the synagogue took 10 men or more, and they had synagogues in every city. That's where the people went. That's where the people went to worship. But in the synagogues, where people went to worship, they had two books that they read. One was the book of the law, the Pentacles. And the other book was the book of the prophets.
Well,
Christ took the book of the prophets, and he said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me.
Because
I've been anointed. Hallelujah, to preach the gospel. My God, and when he read the whole scripture, he said, this day has the scripture been fulfilled in your ear. They said, how can this be? We know this man. We know his mother, his father, his sisters, and his brothers. My God, and they despise him because he said the scripture that day was fulfilled in him. That means that he was here.
Yes,
he was the Messiah. He was the child of born. He was the child that was going to be born in Bethlehem.
Yes,
he was a descendant of the seed of the woman in the garden.
Uh-huh.
My God, he was a descendant of David. He was a descendant of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He was the beginning and head of the church.
Come on,
he was
going
to be the light to the world. He was going to be the truth that would open every man's eyes up. He was going to be the penalty, the capitulation of our sin.
Yes,
he was going to be reconciliation.
Uh-huh.
Everything about Christ.
Everything.
He was going to set man loose from everything that was against man. And when he read the scripture, this day in their ears, they got angry. They got angry about it. And it's men and women that don't want to hear your rhetoric about Christ. They want to hear about your religion. They hate Jesus Christ, and they won't hear one thing about anger and hate.
Wow.
Like they wanted to charge Moses with this crime because they wanted to charge Moses because they hadn't eaten. And one thing about anger, it will not let you be reasonable.
Say so.
You can't have reasonable doubt with an angry jury. There's no reasonable doubt with an angry jury. So what does the news media do? They get them all riled up before they have the trial. My God, they already want to hang somebody before they go into the jury chamber. They done heard on the news that he's guilty. They convicted him, run him 24/7 on the news. And how in the world is a man going to go beyond reasonable doubt with a jury that's hearing the case in the news day and night? And when they get angry, my God, there's no longer any reasonable doubt.
Amen.
That's why Jesus Christ. My God, that's why he left the church into the world, to give the world some reason for that.
Wow.
To let the world know that if I change, you can change. To let the world know that this man, Jesus, was the Son of God. He is a great I Am. He is the way, the truth, and the light.
Wow.
And nobody ever been like him.
Can you consult with him?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. My God, I thank the Lord today for your word. I thank the Lord today for your message. I thank the Lord today for Jesus Christ. I thank the Lord.
Amen.
We try to get that little kid under control here. He got a spinner, and it's like, I'm just looking at the spinner. My God. You know, the mind is a fragile thing. You have to keep it. Anyway, Moses struck the rock. Water came out the rock.
Well,
and the people were able to get nourishment. Anytime you have a problem, people don't go to the rock anymore.
Mm-hmm.
They got too much doubt. They go to the rock. They want to do it themselves. They want to go to somebody else. They want to talk to somebody else and complain about their situation. They don't understand that God said, I got you. I got this. I got you. They want to realize that they want to think that the world got here because smart men created this world. But no smart men did nothing. A man, I don't care how smart a man is, he can't make gas if there's nothing in the earth to make it with.
Say so.
I don't care how smart a man is,
he
can't make a Ford, my God, unless he can get it from the earth. For God has given man all the resources that a man need, and not only did God give a man resources, he gave them a blueprint. There's not a man that made anything in the world significant that it didn't come to him in some part, some way, through evolution or through a dream.
Amen.
And then men want to take the credit. Once they get a little smart, they can do something. Then they think we're supposed to listen to their word. If their word is against that's the word of God, then I'm not listening. I need to tell you something. You don't need to tell me anything. There's only one word in the earth, and that's the word of God. Yeah. And he said, I set my word that the world may be healed, may be saved.
Amen.
My God, I set my word. What I want to say to you today is Christ should be accepted by many more people than accept him. But man won't even reach up and won't even get up and read the word unless he's in so much trouble that he remember some Christians got out of trouble. He remember some joy in some Christians. He remember some Christians that would not forsake the gospel even if they put the lions on them, even if they put dogs on them. And he remembered that this must be the truth, because no man would be able to serve God unless he was real under those circumstances.
Amen.
And that's how the world sees us. But we need to thank God that we live in an hour and a day where God has made the gospel so easy.
Amen.
We should be happy that when we leave here, I mean, we're in the church, we can breathe fresh air. It might be a little hot air today, but we can breathe fresh air. There's so many people that the enemy is working on every day that you know to rob their faith, to keep them out of the church. And my God, the people that's supposed to be in the church so that they can understand the pillars that's supposed to be in the church, the watchmen that's supposed to be in the church on the wall, so these men and women can see,
amen,
that God is real.
Yes.
They got more doubt. They have more doubt than the doubters. Whenever you start speaking doubt, or you start murmuring and complaining, and you are a covenant child of God.
Uh-huh.
You're not murmuring and complaining against Moses anymore. It's beyond Moses.
Amen.
Way beyond Moses. You're complaining against God because God says he got not only gave you a gift, but he said your gift. I'll make room for you.
Amen.
I'll tell you one thing about it, brother. When they hated David, when King Saul hated David, it wasn't because David was a bad man. It was because David was a good man. When King Saul had no need, no use for David, it's because David was a mighty man of God.
Uh-huh.
And the same way they hate David, they're going to hate you.
Say so.
My God, when people start hating you, don't get confused. Let it draw you closer to God.
Say so.
My God, but you got to remember one thing. They need to hate you for righteousness' sake not for unrighteousness' sake.
Uh-huh.
You got to understand, hallelujah, that everybody that say Lord, Lord, don't have the purpose of God in their heart.
Say
God
so.
Is not judging a man by what he does. He's judging a man by the reason that he does what he does.
Say so.
God is judging a man by his purpose.
Uh-huh.
It is hard to do what needs to be done. If a man just walk by sight, not by faith, that person could be destroyed, because you could be misled by everything. The only way you would be able to see anything if you carry a flashlight around with you 24/7. You need a bright light to see at night. So if you got the light in you, you won't always be stomping your toe at night.
Amen.
Because the light is there. Somebody stand to your feet. Let's give God a praise.